Thank you for your love, Lord. Thank you that you loved all of us equally and that we're all equal at the foot of the cross. We praise you today. Thank you, Father. Well, welcome, everybody. I don't even have to ask you to sit down. Hallelujah. So if you're first time here with us, anybody? We just love seeing family each week, so God bless you. And on Facebook, if you're with us for the first time, then put it in the chat so we know, and we'll get back to you. Tuesday Bible study with Pastor Deb with the prison letters that she's sharing. This week is group, so please bring a snack to share, and we will have our group time after the message. And if you can please stay after the service and help us break down and set up the tables, that would help. Thursday Bible study in the book of Genesis with Pastor Deb from North Carolina. You can join her and all of us on Facebook at 11:45. There will be no bridge meeting this Thursday as it is 4th of July, but bridge will resume on July 11th. We are honoring our graduates of 2024 this morning. So amen, amen. So please stay for some light refreshments and to congratulate and bless our graduates today. Kingdom couples will meet on Friday, July 19th at 6:30. And Pastor will be giving you more information about that. Our giving platforms are text to give, covenantmessiah.com/donate. You can mail your offerings. And we will take up our offering now.
Hallelujah. 1 Chronicles 29, verse 10. Therefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregation. And David said, blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and is in earth is thine, and thine is the kingdom. O Lord, and thou art exalted, head above all. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all. And in thy hand is power and might, and in thy hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all. But who am I, said David, and what is my people that we should be able to offer so willingly after the sword? For all things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. The Lord says, I know also, my God, that thou triest the heart and hast pleasure in uprightness. But as for me, in the uprightness of mine heart, I will willingly offer all these things. And now have I seen with joy, thy people which are present here to offer willingly unto thee.
So we praise you, Lord, and we thank you for our increase, because all increase comes from you. As your word says in the book of Deuteronomy, it is he who gives us the power to obtain wealth in order to establish his covenant, which he swore unto our fathers, even as it is unto this day. Because God will supply, our God will supply our every need according to his riches and glory through Christ Jesus our Lord. The word says, give, and it shall be given unto you. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Joe, for that prayer. Hallelujah. It is his good pleasure to give us the kingdom. Glory to God. And I thank the Lord for his covenant. The Bible says he will give us all sufficiency in all things. Well, today we are celebrating all of the graduates. I'm going to call the graduates up here. If you are graduating in any area, moving up, going into college, going into trade school, anything that you're doing, we are going to pray over you because we believe that there is power in prayer, and we thank God for you guys. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Come on up. Come on up. It's a tall man right here. Come on up. Hallelujah. Stand up here. Stand up. All right. Let us all. Hallelujah. Come on up. Come on up. Get your blessing. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for these young men and women. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we pray the anointing under these young souls, Lord God. We thank you that they are moving forward, whether it be in their education or into the workforce, Lord. We know that you will order their steps, Father. Father, we pray blessing over them, Lord. Let the angels that are encamped around them break down any stronghold, anything trying to thwart the purpose that you have for each and every one of these souls here today, Father God. Hallelujah. We know that you will hold no good thing for those that walk uprightly. And Father, right now we know that they will walk uprightly. We put a hedge of protection upon them, and we thank you for the foundation of faith. So right now we're praying a blessing, Lord. Holy Spirit, just move in their lives. We thank you, Lord, that this place, you are here and present. In Jesus' name, amen. Man, you guys can... What's that? That's all right. Praise God. You stepped out in fear. Glory to God. Let's say that, right? Stepping out in fear is so powerful. Your blessing is right on the other side of fear. So I thank you for sharing that with me. Glory to God. What will you be doing? Where are you going into college? Trade school. That's what I'm talking about. We need more. And what will you be doing? Trade school. Hallelujah. Do you know you could go to a graduation at a public school and you'll probably might be lucky to see one out of 1,000? And right here, I got two that are going in to trades. Glory to God. And what will you be doing? Hallelujah. And how about you? What will you be doing? College. Glory to God. Education is so, so important. You guys may take your seats. Glory to God. We're going to have a celebration for these young ladies and men. And everyone, please stay and join us as we're going to have some light refreshments. And now it's time, my favorite part, to pray over the young souls. Come on up here. Hallelujah. Stand right here in front. We want everyone to be able to see you. Glory to God. God is so good. I thank God for you. Oh, we pray for you. How powerful is prayer? It says the effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. And right now we pray over these souls, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, each and every day. We do not stop praying, Lord God. We know that strongholds are broken down from prayer as we go to war each and every day on our knees. Glory to God. Sending our petitions and requests unto you, Father. So I just pray that you would anoint the time that they spend. The teachers, we thank you for the laborers. Glory to God, and continue to do the work in them and through them. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't know about y'all, I'm super excited about today. You know, when my wife and I were in Jamaica, we were praying. God was just ministering to our hearts. You know, we needed that time, the most important ministry besides the covenant that you have with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is marriage. And that is the covenant that will be attacked. It will be attacked. And I know that God has brought my wife and I through so many things. And I share this all the time, that what has really made our relationship strong were the things that we went through. And we wanted to create an environment of transparency, so we are going to have Kingdom Couples, and that ministry is going to start on July 19th. So if you are a couple, if you are getting ready to be married, if you're engaged, or you want to know the principles of what it is to have a godly relationship, that's what this ministry is going to be about, to just put to practice all the practical things in everyday life and marriage. And you know what happens? We all get blessed. We all get blessed by a ministry like that. So God is so good. How many of you are excited about that? All right, again, if you just came, we're going to be celebrating all of the graduates. I'm just so thankful for every single person that is here. You know, it is such, my heart really cares about souls and young men and women, because I know how much imparting into their lives, being a mentor, being an example, can really change their lives, because it did it for me. I thank God for good mentors. Hallelujah. So the title of my message is Seasons Come and Go, But Cycles Must Be Broken. Cycles must be broken. Now, if you've been with me for the past 6 months, you'll know a lot of my message has a lot of repetition to it. And there is a purpose for that, because repetition leads to retention. And retention is the power and ability to retain first in your mind, and then it goes into your heart. Glory to God. So let me ask you here today, are you in a season or are you in a cycle? I don't know that answer, but I do know someone who does. Let us pray. Father, we just, Lord, come to the Holy Spirit right now. That you would touch your people in the name of Jesus. That you will download into them, knowing if they are in a season and how to weather the season that they are in. Or if they are in a cycle that needs to be broken, Father God. That right now, in the name of Jesus, any cycle that is not of you, Lord, will be broken in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the power in the name that breaks every single yoke, Lord God, that there will no longer be generational curses. There will no longer be behaviors that are learned, Lord God. As they leave here today, they will feel renewed and empowered, glory to God, to live a new life that is in Christ Jesus. And we thank you for the liberty and freedom that you have given us, Father. And you get the glory, the praise, and the honor for it. In Jesus' name, amen. The word season means a appointed time. You see, it is an appointed time. We learned last week that everything is ordained by God, and he declares the end before the beginning. So the seasons that come from God are areas in our life that we navigate through that helps us to get better from. These are different seasons, just like it says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, that he that performed a work in you will complete it, and he does it through seasons. Seasons of increase, seasons of lack. We know we have natural seasons such as winter, summer, spring, and fall. Turn with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1. Say amen when you're there. And we're really going to look at the words that the Holy Scripture uses in this verse. Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1 says, to everything. What is everything? Everything is everything. To everything there is what? A season. And a time to every purpose under the heaven. We learned last week to ask ourselves our why. And once we know our why, God will show us the how we do it. So important to understand that to everything there is a season and a time for his purposes. The seasons of our life and an appointed time are for a purpose, but we just need to ask God whether we are in a season or a cycle. He will reveal it to us. We all have the Holy Spirit for those that have received Jesus as Lord and Savior. Truly laid down their life. As Jesus said, if you lose your life for my sake, you will save it. And if you had not done that today, we know the Holy Spirit will draw you to know God. Gnosko, to know God. It comes outside of natural knowledge. That's why it says no one comes unto the Father unless they are drawn. And every single day I get drawn of the Lord by setting aside my time each and every day early in the morning to seek him. And whenever I get caught up in the pride of life, I can take authority over it. We can take authority over the cycles in our life. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 8, starting in verse 20. The seasons of God is his sovereignty, his plan. And his plan is established in a covenant. Starting in verse 20, it says, and Noah built an altar unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. See, we need to understand that a covenant is made by sacrifice. Hold your finger right here. We're going to turn to Psalm chapter 50, and this is the Psalm of David, verse 5, where he says, gather my saints. How many saints do I have here today? You are now being gathered. Hallelujah. Gather all my saints together unto me, unto the Lord. Those that have made a covenant with me by what?
Sacrifice.
Sacrifice. The Abrahamic covenant was made by a sacrifice. He said, get up from out of your family so I can speak to you. The Mosaic covenant. The Noahic covenant. All of the covenants of God comes with a sacrifice, and our covenant with God came with a sacrifice, and it was Jesus' blood. Amen. The new and everlasting covenant. Glory to God. Amen. That he died for us so that we may live for him. Living for him every single day of our life. Going back to Genesis, as you held your finger there, we're going to start navigating our Bibles in this season. We're going to start downloading into our hearts the scriptures, all of the knowledge of the Lord, so we can break every single thing. Because that's exactly what Jesus did when he was tempted by the enemy. He used the word of God. That's what we're going to use. And the Lord smelled a sweet savior. And the Lord said in his heart, God has a heart, hallelujah, a heart for us. And he says, I will not again curse the ground. You see, if we think in our minds, we look at the word sweet smell, it is over and over again in scripture. But when I think about in Philippians chapter 4, when Paul was talking to the church and he said in Macedonia, he said, you gave once under my necessity and then you gave again, but not that I needed anything, but it would be on your account that you would give, because our God will supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. And what he said is it was a sweet smell. Oh, I could smell the Lord. That is a sweet smell, making that sacrifice unto God. And it is not the sacrifice that makes it holy. I said this last week. It is the altar that makes it holy. Hallelujah. Amen. We need to start bringing some things to the altar of God. bring the altar. Bring it to the altar. Anything that you're going through. And in God's heart, he said, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake, for the imagination. Underline that in your Bibles. We need to understand this word. The imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. It happens very early. We spoke about this in previous messages. We don't got to teach a child how to manipulate us. It just happens. Praise God. A little louder. God is good. The imagination of man's heart. In Jeremiah, it says, the heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? Well, I'm going to tell you right now, who knows your heart? It is the word of God knows your heart. If you want to discern your heart, if you want to know about your heart, you need to read more of your word, because it will tell you the intents of your heart. It will tell you everything about your heart, and it will shape and mold your heart, because it is a double-edged sword, for one to use as an offense against the enemy, but also to use internally for open heart surgery to cut off all of the things in your life that you need to shed out of your life, all of the curses and all of the habits and all of the things that no longer belong in your life, and you have the power to do it. It's already in you. It's already in you. The imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more everything living as I have done. And this was where the plan of Christ will come into the world and become flesh and pitch his tent with us to live a sinless life so that we may have covenant with God. We need to remind ourselves every day of the gospel. It says it in the word in Corinthians chapter 15, recall to your mind continually. If you're ever feeling weary, if you're ever feeling down, recall to the mind the day of your salvation. Even if you're happy, recall the day of your salvation. If you're sad, recall the day of your salvation. Always remember the day that the Lord was in your heart and you received him. It was a gift. It was a gift from God. And he said he would never smite the earth again. A cycle is a series of actions repeated that lead back to a similar result. I'm going to take the word cycle out and say, insanity is a series of actions repeated that lead back to a similar bad result. It could also be used in a positive way. Good cycles produce good results. Bad cycles produce bad results. So as we are journeying together through this life and experience different seasons, joy, sorrow, increase, lack, no matter what the season is, they come and go. But bad cycles can keep us trapped. Trapped in patterns of thought, behavior, or circumstances that are hard to break free from. They're hard to break free from. Sometimes cycles that are connected to our emotions affect our identity. We think that's the biggest lie that I either told myself in my natural thinking or the enemy was whispering in my ear was, that's just the way that you are. It's not the way that I was. It's the way the world, the influence of the world had made me, and I was steered in that direction. But my identity is no longer in the world. My identity is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. And he changed my life. Cycles of generational learned behavior or relationship cycles or self-sabotage cycles. What does that mean? You getting in your own way. A lot of times we don't even realize that we are self-sabotagers, or the fact that we have learned behavior, become a product of our long line. If a situation in your family, then that gets passed down no matter how you even feel about it. It innately happens, and sometimes you don't even realize it, and you just need to break free. And today we are free in Jesus' name. In relationships, it can be codependency. Yes. Whew. Yep. I break that curse right now in the name of Jesus over my daughter Alyssa. In the name of Jesus, that there were no longer, that she will be hindered by that spirit, Father God. Hallelujah. Being in bad relationships, I lift her up right now. Glory to God that you are working on my behalf as I take care of your business in Jesus' name. I want no control over it, Lord. You take care of it, and I just trust you right now. These cycles become strongholds. Strongholds are anything that stands between your relationship with God. Anything. And it hinders fulfilling His purpose for your life. And these four young souls that came up here this morning, if I pray anything, I'm praying that God will protect them to live out His purpose. Not what I want. Not what I want His purpose. And that's what sometimes we need to do. That's what I just did with my daughter. I released it publicly in front of everyone because the Holy Spirit told me, that's do it right now. Show the people. Do it right now. Take authority over it in prayer to break everything in your family. And He will. It's not about if, it's about when. These imaginations, thought patterns that cause arrogant attitudes that are influenced by a stronghold, putting an imprint on our minds, that then goes to our heart. And sometimes we don't even realize that we're doing it. But the Holy Spirit, through His word, will reveal it to us. Let's find out. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. God said it, and I believe it. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, starting in verse 1. Say amen when you're there. Amen. 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 Paul says, now I myself beseech you. This word means urgently. By the meekness and gentleness of Christ. Think about this. Read this over in your mind really slow, what Paul's doing here. He says, I am urging you with a meekness. And we learned before, meekness is power under control. I'm asking God to make sure He uses me to only say what He wants me to say as I have tough conversations with my kids or tough conversations with other people that I'm trying to help. And how did He do it? The gentleness of Christ. Those are the fruits of the Spirit on how we move in everything that we do, who is present based among you, being absent and bold towards you. But I beseech you that I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence wherewith I think to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. This is saying this is the type of confidence that you don't see in arrogance or in a place of aggression. This isn't the type of confidence that he's talking about or being all puffed up. This is a different type. This is a spiritual confidence that he has. Being lowly in heart. Not thinking of himself more highly than he ought to. With a gentleness and meekness. It goes a lot further than we could ever think when we just allow God to use us in that way. Because sometimes we think that we're fighting a physical battle, but really we're fighting a spiritual battle. And you can't fight a spiritual battle with a fleshly weapon. Can't do it. Verse 3 says, for though we walk in the flesh, my physical body, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. For Paul to say this is to show that we are not exempt from these wars. In Ephesians, we're not going to go there, but it's exactly what he's talking about in Ephesians chapter 6. He's talking to Christians. The war that we will face and the weapons are not carnal, but they are mighty through God in the pulling down of strongholds. The sword of the Spirit. Claim that authority of the word of God over your family and over your life. Understand it, the power of it. Don't neglect it. You know, God's been speaking in my heart personally. You know, we run a small business, and one of the most important things that we have is time. And one of the hardest things we can do is to be able to distribute our time properly. And there is a fine line that we need to find that will separate us from what God wants us to do by getting too distracted with certain things, such as increase. You know, I shared this in a conversation this morning about you can't have two masters. You'll love one and hate the other. But in that scripture, it's talking about money. It has nothing to do with money in my situation, but it has everything to do with time. I feel accountable to this. I take this very, very seriously because I understand the newness of life that I have in Christ Jesus, and all those other things are just materialistic. And just like we spoke about during our giving in 1 Chronicles 29, just as Joe prayed about, glory to God, he's going to supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. So why do I gotta try so hard? God will direct us on how to navigate these situations if we give it to him. The pulling down of strongholds. I don't know what the strongholds may be, but I do believe that the Holy Spirit is speaking to each one of us individually, because me as a pastor, I can give you the truth, but the Holy Spirit gives you the application of the truth. Because if he didn't, it would be all about me and not about the Holy Spirit. And it has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with God. So as I preach the Spirit of truth, the word of God, it speaks to your heart. Hear his voice right now. Because he's talking through his word. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but a mighty through God of the pulling down of strongholds. And now what do we need to do? Here's that word again. Casting down. I rebuke any thought that goes against the obedience of Christ. I cast it down, hallelujah. Every imagination and every high thing that tries to exalt itself against the knowledge of God. We talked about last week of the prince of the power of the air, what the air waves, the frequency, the things that are happening and they're trying to get into your mind and then get into your heart. But the more word you have, the more free you will be. being in captivity of every thought. We have no control about everything that goes into our mind, but we do have control of everything that we allow to stay there. This is not of God. Be removed in the name of Jesus. I speak the word of God over that thought, and it has no hold over me in Jesus' name. This is what we do. Because Paul tells us what to think about. We think about these things that are true, that are of a good report. You know what is of God and what is not of God. But sometimes we have to use strong spiritual discernment, especially when it comes up into these cycles that are connected to generational learned behavior, relationships, or even self-sabotage. We need that special spiritual discernment that only comes from God through his word. And verse 6. Read this verse every single day, all week. And having in readiness. Are you ready? You ready for some revenge? You ready for some revenge against the enemy in any way he tried to come up against your life? You ready for the double blessing? Hallelujah, to restore everything he stole. You ready? Revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. When you obey, you then revenge all disobedience. Every behavior, every cycle that I lived in, every habit or generational curse has no more bound against me. It is broken in the name of Jesus by my obedience, glory to God, to the word of God, hallelujah, breaking down this war and every single stronghold that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Put the word in your heart every day. Through repetition is retention. You will feel it. You will feel the difference. Sometimes you won't even see it, but other people will see it in you. Wow, there's something different about you. You don't curse anymore. You don't use that name in vain anymore. I'm talking about myself. You don't do this anymore. Wow, you walk away when conversations about women in a derogatory way. Wow, you do this. Wow, you... Didn't happen overnight, and it won't stop happening until the day I go home to be with the Lord. And also with you. Embrace it. It is a great blessing. I don't ever want to spend more time, and I say this with all grace, and don't misunderstand me. I don't want to spend more time listening to preachers than I do getting into the word myself. And I'm talking about myself as well. It's powerful. Breaks in every single stronghold. So now, let us remove all the excuses that keeps us in cycles of behavior that recycles experiences. If you've always done what you've always done, you're always going to have what you've always had. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Starting in verse 17. Breaking strongholds by putting on the new man. Get clothed in Jesus. Make no provisions for the flesh. Verse 17 says, "This I say therefore and testify in the Lord that you being henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk. In the vanity of their mind." That means thinking that has no purpose to it. In the near future, the Lord's been putting on my heart to speak about the seven pillars of wisdom, and we're going to go through them very slowly, and we're going to talk about discretion and prudence, because it is my responsibility to make sure that you hear the word of God and give you a hunger for the word that changes your atmosphere. In vanity of mind, having no purpose, because it comes only from worldly things, pride, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh. Verse 18, having your understanding darkened. It's going to be one of the pillars. Being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. Genesis chapter 8 talked about their imagination and their heart was wicked. All ties in together. I love that scripture interprets scripture. Verse 19, who being past feeling had given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness with greediness. We're not driven by lust or talking about me, me, me. It's always about him. Him, him. And when we do these things, caught in these cycles, we are not so learned Christ. If so be that you have heard him, because faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, and having being taught by him, but we can't be taught if we are not taking the time to be taught through the word of God, as the truth is in Jesus. Amen. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Verse 22, that you put off concerning the former conversation. We already talked about this. No longer talk like that. Do this. Put in these situations. Not going to a particular barbershop. I'm not talking about getting a haircut, but you know the saying, if you hang out at the barbershop long enough, you're going to get a haircut. I'm being mindful of who I hang out with, people that I'm around, things that I do, environments that I'm in. That was the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Verse 22, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. We need a continual renewing of our mind. Be not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing, ing, continuing to happen as the Lord download things to you, for you, by the Holy Spirit. It's individual. He's speaking. And that you put on, this means your attitude, everything that you see, everything that you do, the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Peter puts it like this. He's given us everything pertaining to this life and godliness. This is something we need to put on every day. If we're putting on something, we're putting away other things. Wherefore, putting away lying, speaking every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. There's so much power in truth. There's so much power in transparency and honesty. And if I'm going to do anything, I'm creating, or I'm a part of, through the Holy Spirit, an environment of transparency, an environment of truth that will break every single thing that is trying to thwart or change the course for which the mission of this church will be. We need to communicate. I present myself as very, approachable. Speak to me. Don't let any division in your mind or what you may think or what somebody else may told you. Go right to the source. Glory to God. I'm big on positive confrontation. It's in Scripture. We go to one another. We talk with one another. We iron things out because the enemy will work in isolation or even through what I may think. And I do this as well. I start to anticipate what somebody else is thinking until I get so worked up where I just got to address them about it. And let me tell you, more times than not, I was wrong. But I would stay wrong if I didn't address them. So when I start getting all worked up, I'm just like, you know what? I'm going to go handle this. Go to the person. Let's address this. Let's iron this out. Bring it into the light. That is the truth of it. And then watch what happens. You put a chokehold on that enemy. Put him out. He's under my feet. Glory to God. So that's why it says, every man, truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. We don't even understand these little things that I just explained that happen that causes so much pain or division or thought processes and isolation and self-sabotage. Oh, man, glory, help us. Help me. And it says, be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath or your anger, because what happens? You will give place to the devil. So we may think in the natural, especially when we're going through these situations, I don't know what they are. The Lord may be speaking to you personally on what one may be. And if he does, I am urging you to take action on it, because you will be free from it. And these things that are causing resentment or bitterness, and then if you just address it, then you're giving no place for the devil. Hallelujah. So we're going to remove all the excuses, because we're going to break these cycles. No longer having our emotions affect our identity, because we are not identified by our circumstances or are we defined by our difficulties? Let me say that one more time. We are not identified by our circumstances or defined by our difficulties. God does not ask us about our past to determine our future. He didn't ask me where I came from to call me into where I'm at right now. He said, I did that for a purpose. To show you that apart from me, you are nothing. Amen. But in me, you've become exactly who I have designed you to be. As we're coming into our closing, let's turn to Ephesians chapter 5. One chapter over. Ephesians chapter 5, starting in verse 8. Verse 8 says, for you were. How many used to be's are here? You were sometimes darkness, but now you are light. I could stop right there. Just feel that right now in the name of Jesus. I used to be, but now I am. And I use the word I am as a power that God said, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am a child of God. I am broke free. He says here that you walk as the children of light. Verse 9, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. Galatians 5 talks about the fruits of the Spirit. Go study it during your alone time with the Lord. Understand all of the nine and how they live inside of you and how you can apply it. Verse 10, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord. This is exactly what proves what is acceptable to God. And he gives us an explanation. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. That means expose them. There needs to be some exposing in the name of Jesus. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. There may be some shame connected to it. But bring it out into the light. You know, there's a statistic that one in every five women have been sexually assaulted in their life. And when I think about that, having daughters, what happens in that is that the person that had did this harm to them will tell them, you better not say anything. And then there's so much shame, and I can't even speak to it. I don't even know why I'm talking about it, but I do know that when you bring it into the light, God will bring the right people. This is something that happens and is prevalent in this world that we need to take authority over to expose. Things need to be exposed. Amen. Verse 13 says, but all things that are reproved or exposed are made manifest by the light. Once you put the light into the darkness, there is no more darkness. There is no definition of darkness. Darkness is just the absence of light. There is no definition of cold. It's just the absence of heat. Wherefore, he saith, awake, thou that sleepeth, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee the light. Christ will give you the truth. All cycles and strongholds are broken by the truth. When we expose it, it breaks free. No longer has any boundness towards you. And even Paul describes it about the law. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 5. The law is good, and there's nothing we can do in these physical bodies to attain it. But because we have the Holy Spirit, what it tells us in Ezekiel, that he will put his spirit inside of us and lead us to obey his statutes, his precepts. This is what the Holy Spirit does. Chapter 5, verse 1 says, stand fast, therefore, in the liberty, the freedom wherewith Christ has made us free. I thank God that I'm made free, that I'm not set free. I'm made free. There's a difference, because if you think about it in the context of even recidivism, I did prison reentry for a long time, and I thank God for that. But once you are a part of that and understand, if you just set someone out once their time is out without no rehabilitation, then they will just keep going back to the same behavior over and over again. But if you change their mind and their ways and their habits and their cycles, then they break free from the repeating it over and over again. There's so much power in doing that. Breaking those cycles, because I have been made. I thank God how it says in Hebrews that it is by one sacrifice we are perfected. We are made perfect. For those who are sanctified, Oh, I love the sanctification process. I can feel it when the Lord is just shining an area in my life that I need to change, and I can feel it, and then I see the fruit of it, and it no longer is attached to me. That's the freedom that he's saying here, the liberty that you have being made free. And be not entangled again. Don't go back to with the yoke of bondage. These wars that we face, talking about pulling down the strongholds, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are through God that lives inside of us to be able to break all of those things. My final verse is, turn to John chapter 8, starting in verse 31. As Jesus said to some of the Jews which believed on him, if, underline that, if you continue in my word, if you continue in my word, then, if, then, are you my disciple indeed? So if I continue in the word, then I'm a disciple indeed. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The word know here in the Greek is gnosko, which means knowledge that goes beyond information. It is knowledge that goes beyond actual information from a carnal perspective, but it is a downloading of the Holy Spirit. You just know in your heart, and it implies a very vivid understanding, a relationship between what is known and the knower. Because I know him. I know him. And the Bible tells us to grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us stand. Father, we thank you, Lord, for every provision that you made. Lord God, that we came here together on this day that you ordained before the foundation of the world. And Lord, I thank you that you are speaking to your people individually, whether they are in a season that you help them get through, or whether they are in a cycle that needs to be broken. We thank you for the authority, Lord, that you have given us, that we have dominion. We thank you for the power of dominion that we have in Christ Jesus to put our minds and our bodies under subjection. My mind and my body doesn't tell me what to do. The Spirit of the living God that lives inside of me directs me. Hallelujah. And it breaks every single stronghold. That is the weapon inside of us that is not carnal. And we thank you, Lord, that through prayer you hear us and you break every chain. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So, Lord, as you move right now in the name of Jesus, I just thank you for this opportunity to be your vessel. I humbly submit, Lord. I consecrate my life to you. Whatever you want me to do, Lord God, I'll give it up for you. Whatever, Lord, plan you have, make it clear and plain, Lord God. For you put the vision not in my eyes, but you put it in my heart. The vision, Lord, to think that you would use me. I'm so humbled. And you are going to use each and every person here under the sound of my voice for your purpose and for your plan. And lastly, Lord, I just again pray over those young men and women that are moving into a new season. A season going into trades or the workforce. I thank you, Father. College, glory to God. Get certifications. Download them with witty ideas, Lord, for build up wealth for the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. We know in the last days there is going to be a transfer in the name of Jesus from the wicked to the righteous in the name of Jesus. That is your promise. And we claim hold to the promises of God because they are yea and amen. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you so much, Josh. I was listening to the message, and then I was thinking about this video. We were watching TV yesterday after Shaz, real quick. And we all of a sudden on the TV, it showed this guy, these two guys fighting. And then the one guy hit the guy so hard that he fell and fell asleep. It was like a sucker punch, and the guy fell to the ground and fell asleep. I thought to myself, that's what we did to the devil today. Kid went out. I'm going to send you out with a benediction and a blessing. I have John chapter 14, verse 27, and the Lord was directing me to read the Amplified Version. So it says, "Peace I leave with you, my perfect peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Don't let your heart be troubled, nor let it be afraid. Let my perfect peace calm you in every circumstance and give you courage and strength for every challenge." Take that with you this week. Let it bless you and have a fellowship with one another. We love you guys. If you can stay and help with the tables, that would be great. Thank you so much.